This is University Lecture. Welcome to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today, Dr. Milton J. Rosenberg, professor of social psychology at the University of Chicago, lectures on the topic, The Unfinished Agenda of International Relations, the UN, and Beyond. Dr. Rosenberg.
On the first question, where do we want to get to? And by we, I mean concerned mankind generally, as it examines a world in disorder, a world living at the edge of danger, at the edge of apocalyptic ruin, and yet aware and sensible to the promise of the possibility of remaking the economic order, remaking the material order, so as for the first time perhaps guarantee something like a humane existence to most human beings. As we linger in that strange situation, so close to catastrophe, so close to the potential of human fulfillment at the same time, the answer is, where do we want to go? Quite clearly, we want to go away from catastrophe and toward the fulfillment of human potential. And interestingly, and rather paradoxically, as we think about that situation, the real answer would have to be that where we want to go is away from here. Away from where we are, by which I mean away from the problems that scourge us and have for so long kept human existence anxious and possibly meaningless in the West, and short and brutish for the rest, if you'll allow a bit of doggerel. In the Western world, or really one should say in the northern hemispheric portion of the Western world, life is, for those who are otherwise rather well tended, still extremely anxious and at times meaningless or depressing. In much of the rest of the world, life is merely short and brutish. What are the problems that underlie our restiveness? What are the problems that agitate us, that concern us, and that press us towards some vision of a reordered world more fitting to human aspiration and to human dignity than the one we now inhabit? There are many, many problems. One could immediately lay out an agenda or a list of concerns. You have yours, I have my way of putting it. But I think we can agree that two basic problems haunt man in his social and political existence at this moment. The first is, of course, the problem of war. The peril of nuclear Armageddon, with which we've lived for some time, and which we are courting every day more and more promiscuously. I come here partly as a bearer of sad, evil and frightening tidings. I would not take my job properly done tonight if, among other things, I don't manage to scare some of you more than you knew you ought to be scared as regards nuclear policy, as regards arms policy, and as regards what this nation is doing in the realm of arms policy. That's part of the pattern I want to unfold, and I'll be coming to it shortly. War clearly is one of our two great overwhelming problems. Not merely nuclear war, the threat of which defines the very horror of our existence, but also, of course, the many other kinds of conventionally fought war, internal war, regional war, which also exact very great costs. They exact the ultimate cost of death from hundreds of thousands of persons. From us, safe and uninvolved in those wars, except for the one regional or internal war in which we've become very enmeshed in the last 10 years, for us, those distant wars still extort considerable cost. Cost because we are tempted towards intervention, or cost because, in fact, we do intervene, and so risk our own patrimony, risk our own national wealth and honor, and to be sure, risk coming closer and closer to the brink beyond which lies nuclear war. War is our first and basic problem. Beyond that, there is another. One can put it in many ways. There is the problem of inadequate food, inadequate services, inadequate health, inadequate longevity, inadequate political power available to about half, at least, of the human race. I would simply put all of that under the category of distributive injustice. Food is unjustly distributed. Life, the length of life is very unjustly distributed. We live in this country to the average now to an age of 70. In Southeast Asia, one lives on the average to an age of 30. We have done our little bit to lower the average mortality age in Southeast Asia in recent years. That is to reduce the birth, the longevity estimate perhaps to 28 or 29. Power is unjustly distributed. Lots of people don't have any effective control over their lives and over the decisions that affect the way in which they're going to live out their lives. Human rights are very unjustly distributed. Some of us enjoy considerable freedom, considerable opportunity to unfold the special mystery of our own character and of our own aspirations. Many human beings have no such rights at all, as you know. I think one can group all of these injustices generally under the concept of distributive injustice. There's a certain amount of goods to go about, to be spread around. Goods, whether in the material sense or good in the sense of what one ultimately values. Some of us have more of the good, and it would seem at the cost of denying others their portion of the good. My purpose and method tonight, having posed these two massive problems, which I take to be the defining problems of our special and urgently disordered modern condition, my purpose, having posed these problems, is to do this. First, I want to discuss each of these two problems, attempting to analyze their present shape as problems, attempting to trace out some of their underlying causes, and then to examine, if only broadly and with very little detail, the role of the UN in relation to the management and the reduction of those problems, the ways in which the UN has attempted to intervene in the course of those problems, and the ways in which it has or has not, will or will not in the future, manage to alter the shape of those problems and our prospects as regards their solution. Having done that, I then propose to go on and to note with hesitance, with considerable confusion on my part, but still I want to try to note what I think is an emerging trend, a trend which may represent our best hope for developing a Pacific and a more just and a more humane existence for mankind. And I'll keep you in the dark as to what that emerging trend is. You may already guess or you may not, but it is something in which I must confess I, even in my most pessimistic moods, and these are days that breed pessimism in a sensitive soul, and all college professors are, as you know, extremely sensitive, that I, even in my most pessimistic moods, find some very, very exciting hope in the special trend or prospect or evolving turn of affairs about which I mean to talk before I finish tonight. But first, before we turn to optimism, I must indeed try to scare you and try to provoke you and try to carry you towards some fuller understanding, or at least not a fuller understanding, but an understanding in the terms that I choose to use, of the problem of war. I will not indulge in the banality appropriate to such occasions and regale you for 5 minutes with statistics and extrapolative data concerning how destructive nuclear war would be. I'm sure you're as familiar as I am with what a megaton is and what the scope of destructiveness of a megaton's worth of nuclear power detonated in the air above Ames, Iowa, or Des Moines, or Chicago, or Moscow, what that scope of destructiveness would be. I do mean to point out, as we start talking about war, that there are three types of war possible in the world at this moment. One would be great power war, full direct combat between some two or more of the great powers. That hasn't happened since 1945. Two other types of war are feasible and conceivable these days. Both are happening. The second type is regional interstate war, war between neighboring states of middle or low power. We've had a few of those on and off. We've got one going, simmering on and off in the Middle East, and a very dangerous one it is. And the third type is, of course, internal war, as some of our political scientists and gray eminences of the strategic world have come to label it. Internal war, meaning civil war, meaning war, revolutionary or otherwise, between sectors of a quasi-national state, usually a state emerging from colonial status after centuries of misery in the grip of colonial power. If the great powers have not fought a full war among themselves since 1945, it remains abundantly clear that they risk fighting such a full war to the extent that they involve themselves in regional wars, as the two greatest powers have done and are doing in the Middle East, or to the extent that they involve themselves in internal wars, as this nation certainly has done for some time in Southeast Asia. To understand why our involvement in these non-nuclear wars risks nuclear war, one needs to begin to examine the overall pattern of relationship between the great states of the world, and one needs to examine recent history concerning arms policy and foreign policy and the interactions between these two orders of planning and these two orders of investment. You may wonder what all of this has to do with the UN. I can signal in advance my basic point. The UN hasn't been able to handle this, and the UN will not be able to handle this, but it must be handled. And I want to come shortly to how it might be handled. But before I do that, I want to first dwell still further upon the nature and the extent of the danger. Behind the pattern of mutual arming up and mutual cycling, with the US always in the lead, but the Soviets trying to match, or at least trying to get enough of the same kind of weapons so as to feel somewhat secure. Behind all of this, there lay a conceptual system. I assume that many of you here are of the professorial community, and therefore you will agree with me, I trust, that ideas do make a difference, that ideas have consequences for real decisions. No set of ideas, I think, in modern state affairs have had quite as significant a set of real-life consequences as that set of ideas which, taken together, goes to comprise something that is now called strategic theory or deterrence theory. Deterrence theory is both very new and very old. It's, in a sense, a reapplication of the rules of international competition and hostility, rules developed all the way from Plato through Machiavelli to von Clausewitz. It's a reapplication of those rules, a fitting of those rules and those concepts to a very different kind of war potential. We began to think about the unthinkable, to use Herman Kahn's immortal phrase. Thinking about the unthinkable meant thinking about how you would fight war with nuclear weapons, the kind of war which would destroy possibly four-fifths of the civilian populations of the competing and contesting nations. And very soon, what emerged was a set of basic axiomatic notions, or at least a set of basic propositions. The first and foremost of them was this: to maintain security in a world in which nuclear assault is possible, one must be able to deter preemptive assault taken by the other side. The only way to deter the other side is to assure him, give him full evidence of the fact that if he attempts to wipe you out with a nuclear assault, he may succeed in wiping out your plant and most of your population, but he cannot succeed in wiping out the missiles that you will then use to take full retribution on him. The anchor to security in a world armed up with nuclear power, a world in which two great states particularly are armed up with such nuclear power, is, it was agreed on both sides of the Iron Curtain or both sides of the Cold War, the anchor to security necessarily lies in the maintenance of second strike capability and credibility, to employ the jargon of the strategists. And that means simply that if power A destroys power B with a surprise, preemptive, total nuclear assault, power B, though totally destroyed in everything that matters, will have shielded its missiles so effectively and will have them programmed properly that, more or less automatically, power A can expect a retributive second strike assault from power B, a retributive strike sufficient to destroy power A. This being so, you will have, if this can be maintained on both sides, you get what is called the delicate balance of terror. Another great phrase coined by a colleague of mine at the University of Chicago, Professor Albert Wohlstetter, probably the leading contributor to the development of the strategic orientation in this country. Thus, one of the men, I would say, though I happen to number him as something of a friend and a man whose charm constantly wins me and whom I love to debate with on TV or privately, but nevertheless a man who, as much as any other, deserves the title of one of the most harmful human beings of the century. because deterrence theory, which Wallstetter and others helped to develop, has some terrible built-in dilemmas. The basic built-in dilemma comes from raising the question of forecasting of the short future and raising the question as regards the short future, will the delicate balance of terror still be maintained if they, the other side, change the number and type of weapons they have deployed? The delicate balance of terror hangs on the assurance that one has second strike capability after a first strike assault. Therefore, it hangs precariously on the defense of one's nuclear missile capability against any possible, any conceivable newfangled weapons or new quantities of old weapons which the opposing power may be planning to develop by 5 years from the present moment. Therefore, one must always live some 5 to 10 years ahead of the present moment, and one must always worry as pessimistically and depressively as one can, or else one's security will not be guaranteed. What I'm laying out before you in roundabout terms is a principle built directly into all modern strategic theory. It is the principle, it goes by various names. It's sometimes called the conservative assumption. One should make conservative, i.e. pessimistic and worried assumptions about the military capability of the potential antagonist, and also very pessimistic assumptions about his intentions. The conservative assumption. It's sometimes called the prudential standard. Prudence requires, the standard of prudence requires that we be as worried, as pessimistic, as frightened as possible, and take measures to reduce our fright by matching the threats we anticipate we may be facing a few years from the present seemingly balanced and pacific moment. My favorite phrase for this style of analysis, it's also in the jargon, is that it is the technique of worst case analysis. In DOD parlance, this is what one hears all the time. One uses the technique of worst case analysis. Extrapolating a few years into the future, we looking at the Soviets or the Soviets looking at us must, following the style of worst case analysis, ask, what's the worst they might be intending as regards us? And what's the most they might be developing in the realm of new nuclear hardware and new measures to counter our nuclear assault? We can estimate more or less what the worst may be as we extrapolate from intelligence data we've got. There's great ambiguity. We will resolve the ambiguity always in the direction of the worst possibility. And then what prudence requires is we will go on to meet the worst possibility, to check it by our own investments, by our own research and development, by our own deployment plans. This is the bind we've been in. This is the inner inconsistency or the inner illogic in the maintenance of the delicate balance of terror. Now, you know what it's done to us so far. It has squandered our national wealth and Soviet national wealth and a good portion of English, French, and Chinese national wealth as we have all armed up at higher and higher, more and more technologically complex levels. If only it had squandered billions of dollars, that would be one thing to bemoan. What is more worth bemoaning at the moment is that we have now reached the point in the arms cycle in which both sides have been rushing ahead because of the built-in inconsistencies, the inner paranoid logic of strategic theory and of the maintenance of a delicate balance of terror. Where this has led us, actually, is to a point at which, trying to keep ahead of one another, we have now entered into a new technological phase, a phase in which we are finding ways to invalidate second strike capability, or we think we may be invalidating second strike capability, and this will grossly unbalance the delicate balance of terror. What I refer to here are the linked developments of anti-ballistic missile systems and of MIRV warhead delivery systems, multiple independently targeted reentry vehicles. What do these have to do with disrupting the delicate balance of terror? Nothing would be more offensive than an effective defense. An effective defense against nuclear assault, if any nation had it and mounted it, would say to its opposing nation, if that opposing nation is working with that paranoid system called strategic theory and living by the worst case analysis sort of conceptual style, then the mounting of an effective defense system by one nation would say to that other nation, these people are getting ready to attempt preemptive assault against us. They can attempt preemptive assault against us because they have now shielded themselves against the second strike that we would be able to throw back at them. Their first assault would be aimed not only at our cities but at our missiles, but it could not destroy all our missiles. Our missiles are defended against assault. They can be destroyed, but it costs a lot to destroy them. Some of our missiles will survive. And they know that and have always known that. And that's what has restrained them from attempting preemptive assault in the past. But now that they have mounted a full continental defense against nuclear missile assault, they can, with more or less impunity, proceed to attack us and devastate us. And then the missiles of ours that they have not destroyed will, though we send them off to bomb the enemy, will be countered. One or two may get through, or one or two of their cities may be destroyed, but that's obviously a price they are prepared to pay. Now, the movement towards ABM generates just that sort of anxiety. The movement towards MIRV generates an even greater anxiety. I know I'm lapsing here into a little bit too much detail, but for years I've been very preoccupied with this stuff. I've been poking around Washington as much as I can. Social psychologists have some relevant skills, or at least relevant delusions of grandeur, to bring to this kind of analysis, because ultimately strategic theory is based, as you see, upon certain psychological propositions, propositions involving ways of estimating the behavioral intentions of an opposed elite. And there are certain psychological dilemmas built into strategic theory and into arms policy, which I think require the special hand of a psychologist. Maybe not a social psychologist, but a clinical psychologist or a psychoanalyst, which I am not. MIRV poses a further problem, and it's one I think that most Americans don't know much about, and I wish they did. One of the things that has anchored the delicate balance of terror against regressive recourse to a Sunday afternoon in which we will destroy ourselves and destroy the world in a one afternoon full nuclear war, one of the things that's worked against that has been the shielding of ICBMs, the shielding of intercontinental ballistic missiles in deep silos in the ground surrounded by steel and concrete meshes, which in fact insulate them from destruction unless you get a hit with another nuclear missile pretty close on target. Targeting accuracies are good, but not quite that good, so that you can't get a one-for-one destruction of ICBMs. We haven't reached the level at which one ICBM can fly 7,000 miles and destroy another ICBM. We have reached the level in which three or four ICBMs can be targeted so as to go towards one ICBM silo, and in a scatter pattern of directed aim can so land in the general area as to destroy the one missile in the ground. But that, obviously, is a very poor cost ratio. If it takes three or four missiles to destroy one, and if we have equally matched ICBM forces, as now finally we do, for a long time we had about three or four times as many ICBMs in the ground as the Soviets did. They have, within the last few years, caught up with us. In fact, they now have about 100 more than we do. If we use our whole ICBM force in a preemptive assault against the Soviets, we could only destroy about one-third of the Soviet ICBM force, leaving them two-thirds then to throw at us and our cities. Obviously, then, deterrence persists, and we can't overcome deterrence on that basis. MIRV, as you know, is a missile, a conventional missile, for us the Minuteman missile, for the Soviets the SS-9, a missile with a number of warheads on top, and these warheads are separately targeted. They can be directed towards separate targets. They can, in fact, in the latest foreseen development, even take orders for target change in mid-course after they've split off from the missile that has launched the warheads into their ballistic arc. This being so, and with further miniaturization in warheads, so you can now put three or four megaton warheads, each a one megaton warhead, on a single Minuteman III missile. This being the case, and looking forward to a 9 or 10-headed missile, which we should have in a few years, that's on the boards for us, and one would assume for the Soviets, you then have, if you assume, say, 5 years from now, 9-headed MIRVs, you have the following situation. We have 1,000 MIRVs, each with 9 heads, deployed in holes on the continental United States. The Soviets have the same in their homeland. In a preemptive assault, one could now, with a single MIRV missile with its 9 warheads, destroy 3 MIRV missiles in the Soviet homeland with their 3 times 9, 27 warheads. If it takes 1 megaton warheads to destroy a missile, Then, if you get that missile while it's still in the hole in the ground, you destroy 9 warheads with 3 warheads, leaving 2 other missiles or 6 other warheads, which you can also destroy with the remaining warheads off your same single missile. The assault to destroy ratio now tilts decisively in favor of the aggressor. I hope I've made that clear. It's really a very simple point, just a matter of arithmetic, but I know I'm rushing it a bit. What's even worse is that the United States is rushing it considerably. For years, the Soviets have been saying to us, one way or another, let's not have ABMs. By all means, let's not have MIRVs. Let's negotiate a moratorium on those things. And we have been saying no. Now, that simplifies the record of international negotiation within UN sponsorship at Geneva or beyond UN sponsorship. That simplifies the record of international negotiation, but it doesn't do it gross injustice. Essentially, when it comes to the arms race, we have been rushing faster than the Soviets and have been ahead at every point. They rush to catch up with us. They're very frightened. Their utilization of the prudential standard requires them, once we have signaled our intent to build a total continental ABM defense, and we had laid out that plan by 1962. It was the Nike X plan that pushed the Soviets into building the Galosh ABM system, which they installed around Moscow. We then used the existence of the Galosh deployment around Moscow, 60, as we estimated them, quite ineffective ABM-like missiles. We used that to justify a vast claim by the Department of Defense upon our Congress for funds to pay for a total continental ABM defense. That was President Johnson's Sentinel system. Something funny happened in terms of public response to that, in terms of the organization of mass protest, or at least significant protest from attentive publics. President Nixon, when he inherited power, inherited the problem of how to get an ABM across, despite a lot of opposition among the citizenry and in the Senate. And he did a fancy public relations operation and renamed it Safeguard, gave it a different mission. This would now defend not cities, but missiles. Managed after a great fight to get it through, as you know. We have since then announced that we're going not for the hardpoint missile defense of missiles, but we're going for a total ABM system which will defend missiles from assault and which will defend our cities and will be a total ABM defense. We used what we scared the Soviets into doing to justify our doing something worse. On MIRV, the story is even more horrid. The Soviets don't have any MIRVs deployed. They are about 2 years behind us by our own intelligence estimates in the R&D work necessary to mount MIRV missiles. A week before the Vienna round of the SALT talks began, we deployed our first MIRV missiles. We now have them in silos, more or less ready to go. We are also rushing ahead in the MIRV arming of our Polaris submarines. As we turn the Polaris fleet into a Poseidon fleet, we are MIRVing our undersea missiles. This is very threatening to the Soviets and is having consequences in terms of their rushing on ahead. Now, I've lingered over this in great detail because it's a threat to world peace which most Americans, literate, concerned, politically oriented, and interested Americans, it's a threat which they don't really understand in its proper detail. That they don't understand it isn't a matter of their own incompetence or their own laziness. Many of the facts on these matters have simply been withheld from the American public or have been fuzzed over behind a miasmic screen of public relations which distorts just about everything in the picture. It's also terribly important because by moving in this direction, we are also moving a number of significant steps closer to the possibility of igniting total thermonuclear war. Why? In all that I've said, I've begged a very important question. It may have sounded up to this point that I'm saying the Soviets think we want to wipe them off the face of the earth unless they can dissuade us by deterrence. And comparably, we think the Soviets are ready at any moment to wipe us off the face of the earth unless they can dissuade us by deterrence. That, of course, is not the situation. On both sides, at the highest levels, most men don't want another war. The Soviets don't want the United States destroyed. The U.S. doesn't want the Soviet destroyed. Rather, on both sides, there is great fear that as the game of geopolitical contest between these two superpowers goes on over this decade and coming decades, and as that game of geopolitical and ideological and economic competition rages on, as all of that goes on, confrontations at crisis points between these great powers will have to be adjudicated through the Clausewitzian game, through the threat of recourse to arms. Knowing that that old game is being played with these very new tools, it is understood on both sides that there is danger that at some point or other the antagonist will feel compelled to undertake preemptive assault. Particularly, I should have pointed out, now that you've got MIRVs getting set up and will have them set up in 5 years fully, unless this is stopped, dead in its tracks, and indeed reversed, what you will have, of course, is a specially unstable situation in which there is now good reason to fear that the other side, if there is a geopolitical crisis that's becoming very tense, and you can visualize one, can't you, in the Middle East, between us and the Soviets within the next year. If there is a hot geopolitical crisis with both sides posturing, as we both did for a while in the Cuban crisis or earlier in the 1956 Middle East crisis, with both sides posturing and saying we will not back off, we will contain you with our power, if that is the definition of a standoff or a face-off situation in geopolitical conflict, then with the new attractive, advantageous assault-to-destroy ratio, which ABM and MIRV will make possible, a strategist sitting in the Kremlin will have to say, to the top elite, will have to say, their best answer may be to assault us. And if they do, they can destroy a good deal. They can destroy probably all of our land-based ICBM force. And by the way, with further technological developments now in the works, it may be possible to penetrate the water barrier and destroy a large part of the deployed submarine force. There are reasons to think that that's the new great coming technological breakthrough. If in technological evolution we reach a level at which a first strike seems possible, an effective first strike, which knocks off most of the second strike capability of the side you're attempting to destroy, then either side, when things get hot between them politically, will have to worry, if they're following strategic prudential standards, will have to worry that the other guy is about to steal the march on you and is going to assault you preemptively and making it impossible for you to assault him back. If you reason that that's the likely response he will make to you, what is the prudent response you then have to conceive for yourself? To avoid being preemptively destroyed, you have to consider, what shall we call it, pre-preemption. And on either side, one playing the strategic game, leaders will have to think in terms of the likelihood of being preemptively assaulted. They will have to conceive pre-preemption. Then they will have to conceive that on the other side, people just as smart as them are sitting around thinking, and though they don't want to attempt a preemptive assault, they recognize that maybe the opposite side is expecting a preemptive assault and is planning pre-preemption. Therefore, the only rational response is we don't want to do a preemptive assault, but we will have to do a preemptive assault because they are planning a preemptive assault. Do you follow? It's mad. Yet it's mad with a perfect interior inner logic. And when I called it paranoid before, I wasn't kidding. The very nature of the paranoiac disorder, fully flowered in an individual pathological personality, is to make certain assumptions about hostility from other agencies. And though those assumptions are wrong, living by those assumptions, one then takes measures to destroy those agencies before they produce one's own destruction. From that point on, the whole thing has a fine intrinsic interior logic. I have taken far too long on this, but it's one of my passions, all the more so because the great hope we had for reversing this cycle, a cycle which on both sides, many men at elite levels want to undo. Just consider the United States Senate and the 30 or 40 or sometimes 50 senators who are trying to interfere with our ABM and MIRVing operations and have come close to succeeding, but have not yet really succeeded. There are Soviets, similarly, leading Soviet physicists who've denounced their government for its arms policy, and that's harder to do in the Soviet Union. On both sides, there's great tension and great concern. The SALT talks were our best hope. The SALT talks, I must tell you, and some of you will disagree, some of you, I don't know how you'll respond to it, but I am quite convinced that the SALT talks have been sabotaged, essentially, by the American military. the sabotage lay essentially in the Department of Defense and the Joint Chiefs and many associated strategic advisors urging the White House to take MIRVs out of negotiation, to make clear to the Soviets that we would discuss ABMs and limitation of conventional UNI-headed missiles, but we would not discuss MIRVs. We are going ahead to deploy them. We did then decide to go ahead and deploy them, and we did tell the Soviets at Vienna, as we had not said earlier at Helsinki, where we were setting the agenda, but we did make very clear at the beginning of the Vienna round that MIRV was out of discussion, was out of contemplation. We had decided to go ahead and mount it. The Soviets are now rushing to mount their MIRVs. One thing the Defense Department didn't tell America is that the SS-9, the great Soviet missile that is to be MIRV-headed, and which we've been frightening Americans with for some time, that for 9 months, up till a week after the Vienna round began, for 9 months the Soviets had stopped all deployment, or rather all construction of SS-9s and any deployment of SS-9s. They stopped dead as a way of saying to us, we'll stop if you will. After we started again, they've been rushing ahead. Well, what's the way out? There are two answers. What's the way out of this slip towards doomsday, this drift towards doomsday, which we're likely to proceed on, unless we take nuclear alternatives out of the continuing geopolitical conflict between the two superpowers and their related partner states? What is the way out? There are two answers. One focuses on the immediate danger, and the other is an answer in long-range perspective. One answer is pointed towards the sufficient condition. The other points towards the underlying necessary condition, which might generate total annihilative apocalyptic war. At the level of immediate measures, obviously what is required is a cutback and some kind of agreed restriction in nuclear weaponry. We've been after that, as you know, and the UN has been after that through its relevant agencies for some 20 years. We must defuse the nuclear array of destructive forces. How might it be done? We could immediately agree to not go ahead and deploy MIRVs, to dismantle their little ABM system and our ABM installations, those that have so far been deployed, and agree not to have any ABM installations. Or we might even agree to defend the two national capitals with ABM devices, but no other cities and no other missiles. That has also been advocated. Further, we could go on, of course. One excellent proposal that's been in the air, some members of the United States Congress are much interested in it, would be the proposal to simply empty out all the silos, the so-called blue sky or blue sea plan. No more land-based ICBMs. If you're still going to have nuclear missiles, have them in airplanes in the sky above and have them in submarines under the sea. That's better than having them in the sky above and under the sea and on land as well. None of this has been achieved yet. The UN record in this regard points to the noble aspirations and deep relevance of the UN to the human crisis of this age, and also points to the structural flaws in the UN, structural flaws which follow from functional realities. I'm not here to knock the UN. The UN has great potential, I think, but not in the arms control area at this point. What is the UN history? The UN Disarmament Commission reported to the General Assembly in 1955 on its total failure to bring any of the nuclear powers together in any kind of meaningful negotiation. Earlier, as early as 1945-46, the Atomic Energy Commission of the United Nations, not of the United States, but of the UN, began to lay out some prospects for arms control and found them rejected by both the US and the USSR. Pressure from the lesser nations, as expressed in the General Assembly resolutions of 1957 and again of 1962, ultimately influenced the major powers towards the one effective restriction of nuclear arms that has been achieved over these 25 years, namely the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. In this, we had not so much a demonstration of the effectiveness of the UN as a body that could intervene with quasi-official status or quasi-autonomous status in the affairs of nations. What we had, rather, was the concerted power of many of the newer states in the world, the emerging more or less neutral states, or the various blocks of neutral states, though some are neutral to the west, leaning west, and some are neutral leaning east, but their claim upon the giant states to reduce the horror in which the world lived, and in fact also, of course, to reduce the radioactive pollution and poisoning of the air, and thus of the bones of children. We did get the nuclear test ban treaty. We didn't really get it because we were being pressed by the small states, but that helped. That helped open up the movement in that direction. Why can't the UN influence the arms race and disarmament in any more direct way, despite the fact that the UN continues to provide negotiation facilities and all kinds of expertise, and does, through its own agencies, some very good scholarly work examining disposition of nuclear forces and other conventional armaments around the world? Why can't the UN accomplish it? Because, I would think, simply, sovereign power and security are still defined in terms of the ultimate power of military response. Sovereign nations define their sovereignty essentially by their control, their capitalization, their monopolization of arms, of force within their own sphere, and their freedom to use that force and apply that force against other nations. This, by the Clausewitzian dogma, which in itself was a culminating statement summarizing a few centuries of statecraft and of emerging patterns of relationship between states, this really is the key to the meaning of sovereignty in the modern world. The monopoly over arms and the freedom to use arms. None of the great states, so long as it intends to remain a state pursuing its own autonomous intentions with full sovereignty, will surrender its military power to an international agency, which is not to say that the great states will not among themselves ultimately adjudicate this matter and do something about arms reduction. Where then does the answer lie? First, clearly, it lies in to treat of the sufficient condition, the condition that would be sufficient to generate full nuclear Armageddon. The first level of answer lies in further work on arms limitation. It lies in such things as the SALT talks and further negotiations to come. But for such negotiations to be successful, there is something needed which we presently do not have, namely a concerned, activated, fully informed, demanding citizenry. We are at a tragic point with regard to arms control. I've mentioned the group in the Senate. You know the names of the leading opponents of the rush towards full militarization. You know the names of the leading critics of arms policy. Your own distinguished Senator Hughes is one of the leaders in this effort. Senators Church, Goodell, whose tenure on the Senate may be limited to just another month or two, Senators McGovern, et cetera, et cetera. Gore, Hart of Michigan, these are the leaders. And behind the leaders, there are some 20 or 30 followers. Senator Cooper of Kentucky is particularly important in this whole enterprise. A fine, dignified, conservative man in the best sense of conservatism, who has in fact played a vastly significant role in rejecting and attempting to limit the arms policy taken by those who hold ultimate decision power. But the efforts of this embattled group of senators, though they've come close to success on a few things, a 50-50 tie on the original ABM funding legislation, the efforts of these senators simply have not been backed by as much concerned public indignation, concerned public activism, as is required. If there is any educational task that Friends of the United Nations, which I take many of you to be, ought to be committing yourselves to, you would, if you'll allow me to turn absolutely hortatory and tell you what to do, you should be educating yourselves, if you're not yet fully educated on these arcane and frightening matters, and you should be spreading your understanding of these matters. People simply must know what modern arms are, what they tend to do to corrupt the internation process, and how close we are to reversing the cycle, if not obliterating the cycle. However, beyond arms limitation efforts, there is a deeper issue. The necessary, the basic cause for the coming Third World War, which may destroy, if not all the world, at least all that most of what we call civilization. I'm not convinced that Third World War is coming, but if it comes, it will come not because we have the arms, but because we use them. And if we use them, it will be because we have gone on playing very complicated and very strongly motivated geopolitical and economic and ideological competitive games with one another. And if we go on playing those games with one another, it will be for a very special sort of reason. It will be because much of the world, as we, the great states, see it, is up for grabs. See, one has to ask, where the whole international system geared to the Clausewitzian underpinning has grown so dysfunctional, so ruinous for the states who are playing the game, where the whole thing has now brought them to the point of, you know, economic injury by virtue of the vast amount of deflected wealth that goes into these armed systems, and always more and more wealth going into systems which grow obsolescent before they're fully completed, where that is the issue, and where we continue to vie with one another at confrontation points in a long-run international game, ultimately anchoring our threats and our attempts to limit one another by recourse to the specter of nuclear assault. The whole game has then become grossly dysfunctional. And on both sides, at all kinds of levels, from elite to sub-elite to managerial to poor, benighted, troubled citizen, people want out from this game, though lots of people still take the game seriously and take it to be a God-given mission. But why don't we get out? Well, that's not an easy question to answer. But I think the answer lies in the fact that the world is up for grabs, or rather that the great powers so see it. Now, what do I mean when I say the world is up for grabs? I mean this. It's a thesis. And to develop it, I have to do it in a nutshell of some 7 or 8 points. And again, we turn slightly historical. 2 or 3 centuries of imperialism subjected essentially the southern hemisphere to essentially the northern hemisphere. Why and how that happened and what its dynamic was is another matter and is too complex and too old for us to get into here. But for some 3 centuries or so, we had a classic imperial structure in which the great nations of the northern hemisphere subjected the underdeveloped nations of the southern hemisphere, though they found a few in the northern hemisphere to subject as well, to be sure. The end of formal colonialism after World War II set loose claims and clamor for just distribution of wealth, of health, of political power, of access to industrialization. The great problem of distributive injustice, which I have now come to in a roundabout way, loosened up at the end of World War II claims for justice. Those claims came from the emerging, underprivileged, impoverished, dissatisfied, sick, starving, undereducated nations. Though they were sick and starving and undereducated, enough within their potentially emerging leadership had been educated, enough food had got distributed so that energy levels had got high enough so that a claim for entry into the modern world was being issued. The great northern powers, by which I mean certainly us and the USSR and England and France and West Germany and Japan, the great northern powers have yielded to this clamor from the underdeveloped, formerly suppressed portion of the world. They have offered financial aid, technical assistance, and arms. As these new states have emerged, longing for the dignity of statehood, one of the easiest ways they could conceive and persuade themselves that they were indeed states, true nations, was to mount armies and to go to war with one another, or to mount armies and begin to suppress portions of their own domestic population, because in fact many of these were not states in any meaningful integrative sense at all, but rather were territories whose boundaries had been defined for colonial administration rather than because those boundaries made sense in terms of the ethnic structure of related communities. We have been yielding to the clamor. We have, the Soviets have, West Europe generally has, Japan has. We've been pouring a considerable amount of investment, a considerable amount of technical expertise, a considerable amount of attention into the modernizing of the underdeveloped portions of the world. Why have we done it? We have yielded to that clamor on the basis of a number of motivations, a very mixed motivational pattern. Partly our yielding to it has been a concern for the general welfare. I am absolutely convinced that in high places you find men of deeply altruistic orientation, and a very considerable and benign and humane concern. I don't believe in conspiratorial elites who are out to ruin the world or are merely engaged in selfish pursuit of venal gain for themselves or for the narrow interest they represent. That such people are around is true. They're around at the top of the U.S. government and probably even in the administration of Iowa State University. I know they are to be found even in the administration of the University of Chicago, but they are very much in the minority and they're almost always not found in top positions and they don't really control policy. The higher a man goes, the more he's been rewarded personally. In many ways, the more benign and altruistic he becomes about the use of his responsibilities for the human good. That is true at the top of our government, in the main, and the top of lots of other governments. It's partly on that basis that we entered into assistance to the underdeveloped world. But there were other bases as well. Another basis was our concern for finding new routes to colonial wealth, neo-colonial wealth, through investment and marketing. What kept the colonial system going, after all, was the economic advantage available to the mother nation in its relation to the colony. That economic advantage essentially came through the skimming off of raw materials with inadequate reparations for the labor value involved in the extraction of those raw materials and the having available controlled markets onto which one could dump a great deal, as well as the geopolitical advantage of having bases all over the world as one jockeyed with naval forces and land-based forces in competition with the other competing imperial powers. There is a neo-colonialism. The dominating relation between the great state and the lesser state still has some advantage for the great state. That dominating relation is achieved now not by landing armies and suppressing the population, but by putting those nations in a kind of economic bondage or a kind of economic dependence upon the great state that is offering the beneficence. There was yet another reason why we and the Soviets and all the other northern powers of any import and size got into this aid and development game. And that was, and it's paradoxical again, we did it to check one another. The U.S. did it because if the U.S. didn't do it, the USSR would do it. And the USSR did it with its somewhat more limited capabilities because if they didn't get in certain areas, it was likely as they saw it that the U.S. would. The geopolitical definition of national security as involving land masses and buffer states and contiguities of borders and so on, all of this, an older aspect of the definition of national security, onto which has been grafted the post-Clausewitzian nuclear horror, all of this required the great states to go on filling power vacuums. You remember that phraseology? We've used it a lot in recent years as regards Africa and as regards Southeast Asia and the Middle East. There are power vacuums. Great states don't presently control. The rising aspirations of these formerly subject peoples are bound to lead some great state into dominance over the area. We had better be that great state, because if we don't, our potential antagonists will. Now, the crucial point I mean to make is that as emerging nations have taken the stance of neutralism, what they really have done, whether they fully and consciously know it or not, is they've put themselves up for competition between the great states, a competition for the loyalties of those neutral powers, and those loyalties are to be bought. While one buys those loyalties, one also, in fact, takes a great deal of advantage because one achieves a new kind of economic penetration of that old colonial area, and it may ultimately serve a kind of further accumulation of national wealth in the major state that has got involved. Either way, the bidding has gone up and up and up. The U.S. and the USSR and the related powers, certainly France and West Germany and England, and certainly on the Soviet side, some of the major Sovietized nations, particularly Poland and East Germany, have got themselves involved in the struggle. They've got themselves involved in it because it really is a kind of an extension of the old-fashioned geopolitics, the old kind of great nation distrust and mutual vying and jockeying around geopolitical definitions of security and advantage. What has further energized this struggle is the almost inevitable fact that emerging nations, as they shed the colonial yoke and put on yokes of their own, will try to move towards industrialization and modernization by skipping the capitalist phase of economic organization. That they will define their economic institutions and plan them along socialist lines. This has tended to energize us particularly into a great concern that we are going to be surrounded by hostile states all under the control either of the Soviet Union or of China, or of both if they ever come together again in concert. Our involvement in Vietnam is essentially due to a long, to an old, quite misplaced obsession that in Southeast Asia, where we must maintain some hegemony to contain China, a move towards socialist organization of economy will undermine our power or will bring those nations into the communist geopolitical power-controlled orbit. There is no reason in the world to think that, there is no sensible reason for assuming that that would inevitably be the case, that a socialist-organized Vietnam, North and South, and unified, would necessarily enhance Chinese power over us. If anything, as you know, the historic incompatibility between the Vietnamese and the Chinese has been such that one might well expect China to be as resistant, one might well expect Vietnam to be as resistant, a socialist Vietnam to be as resistant to China as the socialist Yugoslavia is resistant to the USSR. Now, the point I'm leading towards, of course, is simply this, that we've gone on playing the geopolitical competitive game because of the existence of power vacuums. We've played it through aid, but the more aid we give, the more technically involved we get as individual nations helping other lesser nations, the more we continue to scare one another as great nations facing one another. That being so, the more we continue to remain concerned about potential for nuclear assault because we get into confrontation situations. The Middle East right now is a splendid case in point. These two great giant powers are confronting one another in an area where supposedly a vacuum of power needs to be filled. What then is the way out? I'm saying aid and investment in the emerging world and involvement in it keeps us playing the geopolitical struggle game and thus keeps the war risk very high. What then is the way out? Totally neutralize the world and give it no aid at all? Obviously not. Obviously not. The emerging solution, and you may wonder where in the world the UN is in all this talk, since you're initiating a UN week here. The emerging solution, and the one that is the most hopeful, both for the survival of the UN as an agency in which men will vest their hope, and also for the service the UN can render the world, the emerging solution is the denationalization of technical and economic and development aid. The most hopeful thing I know that is going on in the world today is the development, willy-nilly, almost without plan, almost as an evolution which is halfway up the tree of life before one becomes conscious of it, the evolution of a set of international institutions, many of them now within the UN holding company, some not, in fact, integrated into the UN economic and social apparatus, but international institutions which are coming to render the development and technical aid service to the emerging sectors of the world and are coming to displace the direct involvement of the great, massive, frightening superstates in the same business. Another way I could have said all that I've said up to this point is the scourge of modern life, the basis for the eternal risk of war, is the existence of sovereign states. All kinds of good-willed people know that wars are fought between states. If you don't have great states, you won't have great wars. This is all fine. It's beautifully conceived as it's a beautiful expression of an aspiration for human peace and brotherhood, the parliament of man, the federation of the world. But it doesn't work that way. A federal union, as was true even of our federal union when we got it going, can work only at the lowest common denominator level. It can bring separate governmental units together, only with all of them yielding only as much as the least willing of them is willing to yield. That means that the states of the world, still involved in the game of vying with one another, defining security in terms of threat from the other and the possibility of containing that threat, defining security as who will win out in the struggle for control of the neutralized emerging sectors of the world, such states and their client states and partner states of smaller size will not enter into true federal union on a legislated basis. However, they can slip into it almost unknowingly. That is what is happening in the world. Western Europe is slipping gradually into a kind of federal union because crucial functions in the management of the affairs of those states and their economies and their cultural life are gradually being pooled into international agencies. regional integration of functions rather than of nations is beginning to emerge in many sectors of the world. It's most visible in Western Europe. It's also visible in Eastern Europe. The Warsaw Pact nations are beginning to develop supranational agencies, not under Kremlin control, rather supranational agencies which are de-Kremlinizing the Kremlin in a way. The Soviet Union is beginning to yield some of its sovereignty, some of its right to make decisions concerning its own national life, yield them to supranational agencies within the communist world. There is a great hope that these two clusters of supranational agencies, East and West Europe, will begin to truly contact and interact, that the transactions between them will rise, whether in terms of trade, cultural exchange, scientific cooperation, or what have you, so that, in fact, they will slowly, without any great pact or great declaration which ends the Cold War, they will slowly become so interdependent as to make significant recourse to war between at least the European sectors of the Cold War impossible. While all of that is happening outside the UN, though in contact with the UN, in the industrialized northern world, something else equally or more significant has been happening directly under the aegis of the UN, or in contact with the UN. And that is the development of a whole host of service agencies. There are technical agencies pooling capital from the rich states, pooling technically skilled persons from the rich states and from the poor states, particularly as their educational levels go up, putting men to work in direct technical assistance in agriculture, in transportation, in education, training native personnel, so to speak, back home personnel on a matching basis, pulling those back home personnel into the international agency, sending them to yet other underdeveloped nations. It's a cycling upward and outward in almost geometric expansion of skills, of mobilization of capital. It is transforming the productive capability of the earth, or rather of the farmers who till the earth. It is transforming skills in fishing. We fish internationally much better than we ever did before in nations which must rely very heavily upon fish skimming as a basic source of protein input in their diet. We are developing educational skills which are in turn transforming.
You have been listening to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today, Dr. Milton J. Rosenberg, professor of social psychology at the University of Chicago, lectured on the topic, The Unfinished Agenda of International Relations, the UN, and Beyond. University Lecture is a presentation of Iowa State University Radio.